Currently, someone in the wealthiest 1%, so about 40,000 New Zealanders, has 68 times the net worth of the average New Zealander. Are you okay with that? Should we be okay with that? In his new book, Too Much Money, researcher and author Max Rashbrooke says wealth disparity is unbalancing Aotearoa. Max Rashbrooke is with us this morning. Tēnā koe, welcome to Q&A.
Morning.
We like to think of Aotearoa New Zealand as being an egalitarian society, but has that ever really been true?
Well, I don't think we've ever been a completely egalitarian society, but certainly between the 1930s and the 1980s, New Zealand was a more egalitarian country than most of the developed nations. What's happened then is that we've had the world's biggest increase in income inequality, and we've seen increasingly large wealth disparities. So the wealthiest 1% of New Zealanders own literally a quarter of the whole country. And what I think is also happening is that that increased wealth is allowing people to buy a whole lot of advantages, you know, better access to housing, better healthcare, better social networks and political influence. And that's leading to really significant social divisions that are being passed down through the generations. And, you know, so that idea that we're a classless society, I think, starts to fall apart at that point.
Yeah, the book focuses quite a lot on the development of New Zealand's class system and some significant changes on that front. Tell us what it's like then for that top 1% today. What does the top 1% look like in a classless society?
Well, I think the first thing you can say is that they're increasingly dominant. Research that I've done that I talk about in the book shows that in the 1990s, say, the rich list wealth was equivalent to about 6% of GDP. It's now worth 20% of annual GDP. So the wealthy are becoming increasingly dominant force. They're increasingly dynastic. A bit like in the TV series Succession, you know, there's a huge amount of wealth that's being passed down through the generations that's giving the children of wealthy people all sorts of unearned advantages. And those wealthy people also are living a life that's increasingly distanced from other New Zealanders, I think. Some time ago, I interviewed a relatively wealthy person, and when I asked them how much they'd inherited, they said, well, not much. You know, millions of dollars, not tens of millions of dollars. So if you live in a world where inheriting millions of dollars is not much, you know, you're obviously living a life that's sort of insulated from the realities of ordinary New Zealanders.
Why is that a bad thing?
Well, I think one of the things that a society inherently relies on is some kind of social cohesion. You know, it's very hard to come together and confront the problems that we all face as a nation if people are leading profoundly different lives. When people become sort of segregated from each other, they lose their sense of empathy in each other, that knowledge of how the other half lives. They become less likely to go out and sort of assist people from different walks of life. And I think even democracy is threatened in a way. You know, if people have got so little idea about what it's like for the rest of the country, how can they sensibly cast their vote or make submissions on laws that are going to affect everyone in this country?
But if it's only the top 1 or 2%, why does that matter?
Well, I think one of the things about inequality is that you have to see poverty and wealth as connected. So one of the big factors that shaped New Zealand in the last few decades is that if you go back to the 1980s, workers, you know, people get wages and salaries, used to get about 70% of corporate revenue. That's since fallen to under 60%. The effect of that, that decline in company revenue going to people who get wages and salaries, means that the average wage is now $14,000 a year, less than it would have been if workers had maintained their share of company revenue. Now, where is that company revenue going? Well, it's going instead to the people who own companies, so owners, shareholders, people who've got equity stakes in businesses. So that increase in wealth for people at the upper end is coming at the expense of the average wage earner.
Okay, that is a really critical point. So what you're saying is that is that for the top 1%, you know, they've experienced this incredible growth in wealth relative to other classes. Does the same thing apply for the middle class as well as for people who are perhaps on the lower end of incomes?
Yeah, I think so. I think in a lot of ways we've got quite a squeezed middle class here in New Zealand. I mean, a lot of people watching this will know just how hard it is to, you know, to stay ahead of their bills. You know, the fact that wages aren't as high as they should be, the fact that they're heavily reliant on things like working for families, you know, to prop up their incomes. And what I think they also quite rightly see is that, you know, they comply with all the rules, you know, so they pay all their taxes and indeed have very little choice about that. Whereas if we look at the very wealthy, research that Inland Revenue has done shows that if you take people who are worth over $50 million, nearly half of them are paying less than 10% of their income in tax. So a lot of wealthy people are paying less tax than someone on the minimum wage or someone in middle New Zealand. And I think middle New Zealanders rightly sense that that's not fair.
So to what extent can the middle class benefit from a meritocracy in New Zealand?
Well, I think the problem with the meritocracy, you know, this idea that positions and jobs and things are allocated on merit, is that firstly, you know, the conditions for that to be true don't really exist. I mean, when I look at richer and poorer children, you know, they get totally different starts in life. You know, figures that I've compiled show that wealthy parents spend five times as much on the education of their children as poorer parents do, because they can afford to. You know, and they can afford to buy houses in the grammar zone, which doesn't necessarily get you a better education, but it starts to build the connections with the children of other wealthy people. And then when you look at university recruitment, for instance, it's disproportionately from the wealthiest schools. So over a period of time, over a number of years, if you look at Canterbury's engineering program, for instance, 2,000 students over a period of time, just one of them from a decile one high school. So there are these huge advantages for the children of wealthy parents. And at that point, I think it's impossible to say that there even is a meritocracy, because some people, some children, have such a head start in life.
So what do we do about it?
Well, I think there's a number of things that we need to do. And I would really focus on those things that are the engines of opportunity. So things like, I mean, I'd be really in favour of a kids' KiwiSaver scheme, for instance, you know, so that every child is enrolled in KiwiSaver at birth and the government is doing things to help poorer families save for their children, so that everyone hits adulthood with at least some kind of sort of wealth stake behind them. I'd also focus on things like really pouring money into low decile schools to support the teachers who are doing such amazing work there. I would be looking at things like, could we move to having a free healthcare system, you know, so that everyone can get the healthcare they deserve with no financial barriers. And then in order to fund all of that and to ensure that wealthy people actually are paying a fair share of tax, you know, rather than paying less tax than people on the minimum wage, you know, I'd like to introduce some kind of tax on wealth or inheritances or property or land, something along those lines, to ensure that they're contributing a fair amount to those sort of collective goods that we all rely on.
There will be people who say that what you are advocating for effectively amounts to punishing success. What's your response?
I don't think that's true, because if you look at people who are, you know, aged care workers, for instance, you know, who are looking after our oldest and most vulnerable people, they're doing incredibly important work, but they'll have almost no wealth, you know, because their salaries are so low that they have very little chance to save. And on the other hand, if you look at, you know, wealthy people, you look at people on the rich list, a lot of the largest number of rich list fortunes have come in what's called the FIRE economy, so finance, insurance and real estate, which, you know, and I think it's hard to say that people in those industries are, you know, are doing work that's so much more important than caring for our oldest and most vulnerable people. So actually, I think at the moment, the levels of wealth that people have, the rewards that the economy offers, is massively out of whack with what would actually be fair.
And what is the risk if you introduce something like a wealth tax or a land tax or inheritance taxes, that sort of thing, that you drive some of that capital, right at the richest end of the scale, overseas?
I think the risk of that kind of thing is generally overstated. I mean, not least because, you know, if you were going to go to, you know, any other developed country, you would pay more tax on your wealth or your top incomes. I mean, if you went to Australia, for instance, you'd face a 45% tax rate and you'd be paying tax on your capital gains. You know, furthermore, countries that have comprehensive wealth taxes, like Switzerland, don't see, you know, a huge sort of exodus of wealthy people. That stuff, those sort of things always get raised, you know, they're made as threats, but then generally they're not delivered on. And the other thing is that, you know, actually I think what is important for where people live, and this applies to the wealthy as much as to anyone else, is actually living in, you know, a country that's safe, that's got good infrastructure, you know, where there's a good healthcare system, where there's a really highly skilled workforce for you to employ. And those are all things that are funded out of taxation. So actually, I don't think we would need to worry about those kinds of empty threats that are made.
All right. Thank you very much for your time. We appreciate it. That is Max Rashbrooke. Max's new book is Too Much Money: How Wealth Disparities Are Unbalancing Aotearoa New Zealand.